The Girl Who Grants Wishes, A Christmas Story by D.M. McNamara. Chapter 4, The Forest. A gang of over 20 henchmen, led by the Cardinal and riding on horseback, drew closer to Goliath. He warned Lydia and Nipper that these men could not be outrun. "I wish Nowers was here," said James. "Not being funny, Jim, but she didn't help us out much before. She and that bird just scarpered." Charlie spoke his mind, and for a while there was silence. Then, from out of the night, a voice called out, "You can't blame the forest if you people chop down the trees. But rest assured, once the trees have gone, all will follow." It was Robin. "Robin, I've never been so pleased to see anyone." Lydia's heart soared for the first time since Nowers and Robin vanished. "Thank you for helping us in the streets, Robin," said Lydia. "Dear Lydia, I'm only sorry I couldn't do more." "I can hear this bird talking, Jim," said Charlie in disbelief. "So can I," replied James, looking towards Lydia for an explanation. "Robin, where's Nowers?" asked Lydia. "Lydia, you must be strong. Remember, there's nobody more powerful than you. Release the chains around your imagination. Fear has a hold on you and is preventing you from seeing beyond what's in front of you."
"Fan out!"
Though distant, the cruelty that harboured within his voice gave the Cardinal away. Robin flew and rested on a tree. "Remember, Lydia, your imagination holds the key." "Great, he's gone again. Well, at least Goliath's not running off," said Charlie. "Has anyone else noticed that we seem to be surrounded by trees? Trees bigger than any church steeple I've ever seen."
"And since when did trees grow on the Thames?" said James. "Some of the branches on these immense fir trees reached the width of London thoroughfares."
The density of the forest meant that the snow was not nearly as deep or as relentless as it had been on the frozen river. "Goliath, where are we?" asked Lydia. They could still hear the Cardinal's men, but they seemed to have stopped at the beginning of this strange forest. Layer upon layer of giant spruce branches fanned out above them. "It's like the branches of each tree are interlocking, holding each other," thought Lydia. Suddenly, for no apparent reason, Goliath stopped. Instinctively, the children looked around them, fearing that the Cardinal may be close. But they heard nothing, just a soft shuffling of continuous snow falling through the giant spruce canopy. Darkness consumed the labyrinth of trees on either side of the path. Spontaneously, they all looked back, fearing the Cardinal may be standing there. But all they could see was Goliath's footprints fading into the dark distance like a closing shot of an old film. "Are you all right, Goliath?" asked James. "Goliath?" Nipper asked, speaking directly to his friend's mind. All at once the children were lifted as Goliath took a deep breath, followed by a spirit call that shook through each of the children like a stampede of pure love. The children were overcome with such a release of overwhelming happiness that they all began to laugh uncontrollably. It was a laugh of immaculate joy, such as human beings of the modern age rarely experience. Each of them felt that if the Cardinal was standing in front of them right now, their laughter would infect him, and he would float up to the stars with no more than a thimbleful of their joy required to carry him. From that moment on, these children would never feel fear in the same way. They had felt eternity pass through them. Goliath continued walking, and so blissful was each step within this enchanted forest that when they arrived at a cottage in a small circular clearing, they had no recollection of how far or how long they had travelled. Goliath knelt in the snow beside the wooden porch that covered huge bundles of firewood, ivy, mistletoe, and an array of colourful heather. My friends, my family are calling me from the north of this great forest. It is time for me to leave. This news wasn't as heartbreaking to the children as it might have been had they not experienced that sacred moment within the forest. Goliath had been called by his beloved father, a call the children could not hear, but nevertheless had entered them and left an indentation within each of their souls. My children, you are not alone here. You have friends all around that will appear when the time is right. Then, turning to Nipper and James, and before returning back to the forest trail, Goliath said, "I will always be with you. You have my spirit within you." The children then watched Goliath disappear into the forest, yet their hearts were still buoyed with the joy he had blessed them with. As Lydia faced the ancient wooden door, she felt the urge to reach inside her pocket. She pulled out a large rusted key. "Try it," said James as Lydia looked at him. The key turned the latch and Lydia opened the door. The room had a large fire burning in the fireplace. This brought the children scurrying in. They had been shivering for so long, the thought of heat hugging their bodies made them forget that this was a stranger's house. On either side of the fireplace there were four tanks of warm milk and two large piles of chestnuts and almonds. The children's hunger and thirst overcame any reservations they had, and they drank the milk and ate the nuts. Nipper even found some jars of honey, and the children dipped roasted chestnuts into the honey, and all agreed they had never tasted anything as wonderful. The cabin walls were lined with an array of objects unfamiliar to the children. Sleigh runners made of a curious golden wood, harnesses and snowshoes. As they looked around, Charlie said, "Has anyone noticed there doesn't seem to be a back to this cottage?" Several fir trees dressed with gold and silver hid a darkness that seemed to continue into another forest in the distance. "Listen," said Lydia. The trees whispered in beautiful musical notes that resembled soft raindrops falling on a mountain stream. "What are they saying?" asked James. "They're calling someone," said Nipper. Charlie threw another log into the fire. The trees began to sing louder, and the cracking of new wood burning on the fire seemed to keep beat with the song of the forest inside the cabin. One of the logs hummed in a baritone, another in a bass. Several smaller pieces harmonised in alto voices. Then, among this beautiful sound that filled the room, Nipper began to sing. His diamond-clear soprano voice soared through the air in such an angelic way that Lydia, James and Charlie were struck silent by its beauty. First of all, Nipper sang "The Holly and the Ivy," then "The Cherry Tree Carol." Gradually, as they listened, one by one the children joined in. Lydia even taught the boys her favourite carol, "Silent Night."
Silent
Between
night.
Carols, they occasionally heard distant voices and saw flashing lights through the dark forest. But the children carried on singing.
Silent Night.
Goliath's courage filled their hearts. "This forest hides many things. I have no idea what time it is," said Charlie. "I like not knowing the time," said Lydia. Back home, I have to get up at 7, have breakfast and leave for school by 8:15, arrive at school by 9, have lunch at 1 o'clock, leave for home at 3. The whole day is built around time. I wish we went to school. We have to work all day, said James. The trees continued their singing in the background. Nipper, what happened that made you stop talking? The boys remained silent and watched the fire dance like wildflowers waving at the sky. 2 years ago, the Thames froze, and we all thought there would be a frost fair like there used to be. Dad carried me out onto the ice, but then we heard the ice crack. Suddenly, the ice below our feet gave way, and I remember the intense pain of the cold. Dad lifted me as high as he could. Nipper stared into the fire as he spoke. James then continued, I tried to reach them, but the ice was breaking up everywhere. I remember wishing someone would help us. That's when she came. Now, Az, said Lydia. Yes, said Nipper. She took my hand and tried to reach for Dad as well, but it was too late. I'm so sorry, Nipper and James, said the unmistakable voice of Nawaz from the forest within the cabin. Bobby, called out Lydia, delighted to see the snow girl again. And yet, even within the shadow of this sad memory, so strong was the joy Goliath had left them with. Nipper and James could only smile when they saw the beauty of this angel of the forest. Lydia, I am sorry for leaving you, and yet I have been with you through Goliath, Nipper and Robin. But there is a darkness in your world that shuts me out, and yet I knew Goliath would lead you back to me. As Nawaz spoke, a man's voice could be heard in the distance. Sir, here, a cabin.
Lydia, do you remember I told you that you were a special child that held within you the power to grant wishes? Lydia nodded. And Goliath told you that Nipper was your kin.
Yes, said Nipper, as the children grew anxious hearing the sound of the cardinal's men and their approaching horses. Let me introduce you to another of your kind. Turning towards the depth of the forest within the cabin, Nawaz held up her brightly glowing hand and pointed into the darkness. A row of large reindeer pulling a sleigh, carrying a giant man with a white beard, came charging into the room. Your Highness, said the man, immediately laughing as one of the reindeer sneezed and his antlers cast snow over the children. Lydia instantly recognised his laugh. This was the dream she had when she was 5. Goliath, she said at first, followed by Father Christmas. Is that what they're calling me? Ha! They call me Whitebeard in the cloudlands. I still prefer Nicolaus, said Nawaz, smiling at the giant and jolly man with rosy cheeks and eyes that glistened with a permanent smile. Thank you, Your Highness. My dear friends, I have mixed your wishes up, and I would like to introduce you to a friend. Nicolaus then walked forward and proceeded to open the door to the cabin. The children followed Nicolaus out onto the porch. Outside in the snow, the cardinal and his men formed a long line in front of the cabin. Nicolaus spoke directly to the cardinal. If I tell you that you are confused and misguided about Christmas, you will think I am betraying some false ideal and no doubt challenge me to a duel like you did Melchizedek and countless others.
I will, sir, for you and your kind are making a mockery of Christmas. You have lost your way, and the darkness you are spreading is corrupting the world. But your influence ends here.
The cardinal drew his sword, as did his followers on either side of him. You really must stop bullying the world, cardinal. Nawaz walked from the door of the cabin past the children and Nicolaus and down the steps onto the snow.
"Does this mean you are not going to run away this time, fairy?"
said the cardinal, initiating a ripple of laughter among his henchmen. "I am forbidden from fighting in your world, cardinal. But had you a drop of the imagination these children possess, you would have realised that you are no longer in your world, and that in this world, imagination is the greatest weapon and armoury."
"So are you going to fight and die, or are you just going to die?"
said the cardinal as he led his men towards Noaz and the cabin. "Neither. I'm going to create." Noaz was then joined by a red light that Lydia instantly recognised as Robin. She then pointed her finger at Robin and proceeded to illustrate a figure in the same way an artist paints on a blank canvas. Noaz outlined the form of a great white stallion with wings. "Pegasus," said Lydia under her breath, thinking of her wish to fly home. Then a shield made of sunlight was drawn on the warrior. "The shield of Achilles," whispered James, "the protector." A great sword then formed as Robin flew up the warrior's arm. "Excalibur," said Charlie, "the guardian." The children began to recognise these images from their own imaginations as finally the great knight revealed himself.
It was Melchizedek, the young man from Grecians.
"Life," said Nipper, for within this weak child, life had returned.
"You,"
said the cardinal with fear in his voice as he looked at Melchizedek. Several of the cardinal's henchmen pulled flintlock pistols, but Melchizedek held up his shield. The shots reflected back into them, and they were immediately consumed by the ground. The cardinal motioned for his other men to charge, but Melchizedek raised his sword and clashed with each of the henchmen. Excalibur passed through them like a scythe through weeds that would otherwise strangle a garden of its beautiful flowers. Each time the earth consumed the henchmen. "It's like the ground is alive," said Charlie. "In a way it is. Life continues in many forms," replied Noaz. "Robin," cried Lydia, "I've missed you so much." "Did he? I've never stopped being with you, especially in those moments when you thought I was far away." Even the magnificence of Melchizedek single-handedly vanquishing the cardinal's henchmen wasn't enough to dispel the shock that Lydia suddenly felt. "My grandma was the only one who called me that." Several of the cardinal's henchmen tried to bring down Pegasus by expelling flintlock shots at the magnificent horse. But Pegasus wore the armour of Orion, and again, each shot returned into each assailant. A smaller group of assassins made for the cabin to attack Noaz, Nicolaus and the children, but Pegasus flew like a bolt of lightning and smote them before they could reach the porch. "Don't worry, children, no evil can touch this cabin. But if you would feel more comfortable inside..." Noaz motioned towards the door, but was interrupted by Charlie. "No way! This white knight Melchizedek is brilliant!" Nicolaus laughed so hard that snow from the roof porch and branches of the trees inside and outside the cabin fell in heaps. "The forest laughs with you, Saint Nicholas," said James, smiling. "Saint? My, my! How I remember the world of men!" Not long after that, only the cardinal and Melchizedek remained.
"I've never denied darkness has its power,"
said the cardinal, looking straight into the eyes of Melchizedek, still believing his quest to be righteous. And then something strange happened. The knight cast his sword to the floor.
The cardinal wasted no time and plunged his sword into the body of Melchizedek, just as he had outside Grecians.
The children looked on and beheld the image of a giant exploding snow crystal consuming the air before gently returning to earth. "Does goodness destroy a man who disarms himself and offers himself to mercy?" said Noaz.
"Is this some illusion you taunt me with?"
said the cardinal, watching his opponent, the knight, who had just defeated his entire entourage, fall like playful snowflakes in the wind. The children looked on as suddenly the cardinal himself fell to his knees.
Slain by my own sword.
Blood fell on the snow as the realisation that only pain can bring consumed the cardinal. When you destroy a child's imagination, you destroy yourself, said Noaz to the cardinal.
Forgive me,
he replied, his voice sounding different, as if another person had taken possession of his soul, or perhaps reclaimed it. Only the Great Spirit can forgive everybody, but each of these souls here can forgive if they choose. As Noaz spoke, Melchizedek appeared beside her. He looked at the children and felt their presence in his mind. Cardinal, these children forgive you. You have great power beyond the frozen river. These children wish only to attend school. My child and family and other families you have affected deserve to be looked after with kindness and generosity. You can help with this. If you promise to spread this spirit of gratitude and benevolence wherever you go, my forgiveness is yours, Cardinal. The Cardinal looked into Melchizedek's eyes and began to sob uncontrollably. If this was any other man, the children may have felt awkward, but the pouring out of emotion from this most heartless of men was beyond words. Such a mixture of grief, regret, and gratitude were present in each tear that everyone was deeply moved. They knew that this promise the cardinal swore before all present would be kept until the soul of this man stood before God himself. Noaz then spoke to Robin, who flew inside the cabin, returning with a row of colourful lights that manifested as the reindeers and sleigh. Cardinal, I have a gift for you on your new quest. Nicolaus offered the reins of the sleigh to the cardinal. Seeing his wound had healed, the cardinal stood up and bowed before Nicolaus, Noaz, and Melchizedek.
I will not fail you. From this moment on, I will commit to the spreading of kindness and compassion wherever I go,
said the cardinal. You will need help and guidance, Cardinal, said Noaz. She then turned to the children. James, Nipper, Charlie, we are blessed in this realm to look out on the many paths of souls such as yours. While nothing is completely certain, your path with the cardinal appears adorned with spring apple blossom, cornflowers and hedge primrose. All these signs are magical, protective and exciting. The children listened carefully to Noaz, but James stepped forward. Your Highness, how do we know we can trust the cardinal? Noaz came closer to the children. You are right to be guarded, wise to be selective with your trust. But in this place, no one can lie. The greatest gift of Christmas is life. The cardinal has been given a new life in much the same way as a newborn child. Your wisdom will teach him the secrets only a pure imagination can see. So we're like the three wise men, said Charlie to a sudden outburst of laughter all around. Laughing with the children, the cardinal spoke.
But it's true. You will guide me. I have done many things I'm ashamed of, but I will spend every day of my life making up for them. Will you help me?
There was honesty in his eyes and his words, and the children agreed to return upriver with their new guardian. But how about Lydia? Said James, followed by Nipper. Yes, what will happen to Lydia? Noaz walked over to Lydia and laid her hand on her shoulder. My friends, think how the embers of a cold night's fire warm you in the morning and reignite as you stoke and feed them. As you return from your hard day's labour, you build a new fire, and that same heat warms you again. That warmth is your love for one another. Just as one day ends and another begins, you will meet again, and your love will rekindle as often as you care and nurture each other. This I promise. These words from Nowaz became a supreme blessing on all present, and just as Goliath had released them from the tentacles of fear, Nowaz filled them with a hope and faith that would accompany them always. The children held each other tightly as they said their goodbyes. As James held Lydia, he whispered, "Somehow I know we'll see each other again soon." Although Lydia didn't reply, she felt the same, and James knew this.